saddling 2035 with 2020's decision. And every time that we make one of these business as usual choices to procure fossil fuel burning equipment long service lives, we are forcing ourselves to make deeper and harder cuts in other areas. And this is not an efficient or sensible way to go about tackling a problem like climate change that cuts across all sectors of the economy and all sectors of society. Because those 100 buses that we've just bought, generating 78 tons of CO2 per year, should they live long and happy bus lives and make it to 2035, will have collectively emitted 117,000 tons of CO2 over that period. On the other hand, had we decided to transition to electric buses sooner rather than later, we could have averted those 117,000 tons of CO2 in one fell swoop, in one decision. And rarely do decision makers in complex areas like climate policy get easy wins like that. Because the reality of the matter is, and I think people here will be well aware of that, is that electrifying our bus fleet is something that we are going to have to do at some point in coming years. Because I don't think anyone here today truly believes that in 2050, Melbourne's buses are still going to be lurching around belching diesel smoke into the air while every other vehicle on the road glides past them powered by electricity. The sooner we make this decision, the sooner we can start tackling transport emissions, which are one of the emission sectors that are most resistant to climate action. To evidence that, transport emissions from 1990 to 2016 rose from 60 million tons of CO2 equivalent to 100 million tons, and in Victoria over that same period they increased 39%. And when you consider that in the past 10 years, Victoria's emissions have declined 10% and energy sector emissions have dropped 31%, it makes the task of tackling transport emissions all the more vital and all the more pressing. And if we swapped all of our buses to electricity tomorrow, we would save 1.7 million tons of carbon dioxide by 2030. But diesel buses don't just pollute our atmosphere, they're also a significant contributor to fine particulate matter pollution in our cities, which causes 3,000 deaths per annum in Australia and costs our health system $24 billion per year. Exposure to fine and ultrafine diesel particulate matter is one of the leading causes of lung cancer, heart disease, and stroke, and electric buses pose none of these risks. I think I should hardly need to mention it to this crowd, but this isn't a new or an untested or a crazy on the horizon technology. China already has more than 300,000 electric buses on its roads, and the city of Shenzhen in China swapped its entire fleet of 16,000 buses to electricity, which is a process that they began in 2009. So this is on. Other cities which have committed to wholly transitioning their fleets to electricity include Paris, Los Angeles, New York, London, Copenhagen, Barcelona, Vancouver, Milan, Auckland, and Cape Town. So this is a global shift, and it's gathering pace. And if we make the call to electrify our bus fleet, we won't be doing it alone. And as more and more cities get on board, so to speak, battery costs are coming down, charging infrastructure is becoming easier and cheaper to install. And one of the great things is that, as we know, with electric vehicles, taking into account fuel savings, because electric buses use 72% less energy to travel the same distance. Electric buses are already cost competitive with diesel buses over their lifetime, including the additional infrastructure. And when in 2015 BCD ran the numbers and modeled this, we found that electric buses cost 12% less over a 15-year service life than an equivalent diesel-sized bus. And Bloomberg New Energy Finance estimates that by the early 2020s, electric buses will be cheaper now on a per unit basis than diesel buses, as battery costs fall from 26% of total cost, vehicle cost, down to 8%. And we'll see this in the thing with electric cars, of course. And one of the wild things is the company we gave the $16 million to buy 100 new buses to Transdev is the world's leading, outside of China, the world's leading electric bus fleet manager. They've got the largest electric bus fleet in Europe, and they run a fleet of 400 electric buses in Amsterdam. So they have the skills and they have the knowledge, and they could already do this here. Of course, electrification without renewable transition is only half the battle. I know considering all that excellent work, I anticipate that the additional 127 gigawatt hours of electricity that we would need to power our 100% electric buses to make them 100% carbon neutral should be too hard to come across. But none of this, of course, I don't want to try it all. None of this is to suggest that it's as easy as snapping your fingers and making it happen overnight. Of course, there are challenges and costs to any large transition, and we see that in all sectors of the economy as the climate changes. But those costs will always be there waiting for us when we eventually decide to make this inevitable transition to an electric bus fleet. The only thing that we are doing by delaying this decision is allowing our current fleet of dirty diesel buses to pump more CO2, more nitrogen oxide, fine particulate matter into our atmosphere and into our city. But swapping to electric buses is not just a climate and health intervention. It's an opportunity to reinvigorate our underloved bus network. Because as our city continues to grow, considering the multi-billion dollar price tag that is attached to great infrastructure upgrades, buses will become more and more important in getting people around our city safely and cleanly. Other cities around Australia and the world have far higher ownership rates for buses than Melbourne. Sydney and Brisbane trumps handily on bus usage, as do most large international cities. For instance, in London, 2/3 of all public transport trips are taken on buses. And of course, our beloved tram network plays some role in dampening demand for buses, but that argument only holds in areas where they compete. So in Deer Park and Dandenong and Frankston, trams cannot be blamed for low road chairs for buses. And the wonderful thing is that international research and international experience suggests that people strongly prefer riding electric buses to those powered by other means like diesel. Electric buses are smoother to ride, they are quieter, they are faster up hills, they don't smell the fuel inside, and they don't pollute the communities in which they operate. And if we couple these benefits with a broader reinvigoration of our bus network, so that means higher frequencies, it means more priority lights and intersections, bus lanes, live bus arrival and departure information, and greater customer comfort, that will bring our bus network into the 21st century. Electrification can be the totemic change that gets people excited about buses again, and gets communities excited about a mode that can often seem more of a chore than a charm. Because a high-capacity electric bus network serving Melbourne's middle and outer suburbs, linking, of course, with our expanding train system, would get people out of their cars, out of traffic, and to their destinations comfortably and efficiently. We already have here in Melbourne the world's preeminent light rail system. We are desperately attempting to build a rail network to match. But where is the vision for our buses? And we immediately believe that electrification can be the start of that vision. Finally, last but not at all least, by getting on the front foot and leading the nation on electrification of bus fleets, Melbourne has an opportunity to reinvigorate our automotive manufacturing sector. In the press release that I cited earlier, the Minister for Public Transport, the Honourable Melissa Horne, announced that the procurement of these 100 buses would lead to 20 ongoing positions, building them over the next couple of years as a result of local procurement rules. And of course, 20 jobs is excellent. Excellent thing. But imagine the scale of the opportunity if Victoria led the nation, seized this opportunity, and led the nation in electrifying our bus fleet. Not only could we electrify our own 2,000 buses over the next 10 years, but we would develop the skills and capacity to become the go-to provider for other jurisdictions and transport operators wanting to move to cheap, clean, electric bus transport. Because the ABS in 2011 reported that there are 88,000 buses of all shapes and sizes in Australia. It's a massive opportunity for Victoria's advanced manufacturing sector. And companies like electric truck maker SEA, we just had here before, understand that, because they've got plans to assemble 2,400 light electric vehicles down in Latrobe Valley, supported by the Victorian government to do that. And we would say that the Victorian government should support similar efforts to start constructing Melbourne's new fleet of electric buses here. Because the clean energy industry and manufacturing transition will throw up dozens of these opportunities across every sector of the economy. But it will be the first movers, the early adopters, the movers and the shakers, like some of the companies we've got here, who will reap the rewards of that transition. So, electrification of our bus fleet could be a catalyst, a significant CO2 savings, health improvements, transport improvements, and economic opportunities. And we can see these opportunities, but it will take vision and long-term planning for the government to make it happen. So next time the Victorian government is going to spend $16 million procuring new buses to get Melbourne and Melbourne into that growing city, how great would it be if they bit the bullet and made them electric buses and started this transition? And we would say, potentially, that the first buses to go should be the smart bus out of the city, the high-frequency buses to places like Doncaster, which would get, for a start, those dirty diesel buses out of the CBD, and would also be fabulous for flying the flag for electrification of our bus network for commuters around the CBD. Because buses have spent too long at the bottom of Melbourne's public transport hierarchy, and I for one hope to see Melbourne's quick, clean bus network competes with our trains to be our second favourite form of public transport. It's an exciting prospect, and I hope to see sooner rather than later. I apologise.